say that the Lord will take away from thee all sickness. Now, sicknesses in the Old Testament of the Old Covenant was based on people diligently what? Hearkening to the voice of the Lord and doing that which is right in his sight. When God told them to abstain from idols, and he, they didn't have the same commandments that we have today under grace. But he told them there are certain things that they had to abstain from and not do. And if they would do that, he did say that he would take away from them all what? Sickness. Okay? God says of fearing the Lord and departing from evil, he says that it shall be health or medicine to thy bones. By departing from evil, it shall be health. It shall be medicine or moisture to thy bones. Faith always implies obedience. Paul instructed the Ephesians to obey the fifth commandment, that it may be well with thee and thou mayest live long on the earth. Naaman's, this is the story that we're going to be reading if we have time. Naaman's surrender and obedience to the word of God was complete before he was healed. It is to those who walk uprightly that it is said, no good thing will he withhold. How many remember that? Lord God is a what? Sun and shield. He gives what?
Grace and glory.
But what? No good thing will he withhold from them that what? Okay. Therefore, before seeking anything from God, we should yield ourselves to the first and great commandment, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, because he has set his love upon thee. This is Psalms 91:14. This is what it says. God says, because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I what? Deliver him. He keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him and keep his commandments to a thousand generations. So we can see that God's promises are only to the what? Obedient. That's the reason why many times things don't work, because many times we probably just commit to a partial obedience. Am I preaching tonight? A partial obedience, not a full surrender.
Amen.
So we're just, kind of letting y'all know why, amen, why the money ain't coming in, and amen. Why we're in that $1 million home, and why, amen, that Rolls Royce is not in your driveway, whatever it is. Just kind of letting you know, amen, praise God, why the sick ain't being healed, and people ain't being challenged to get saved, and all of the other. We just kind of want you to know some of the reasons, because sometimes it seems like it's a mystery. It's a mystery to us why all of these blessings are offered to us in the Word, but we never see them what? In manifestation in our lives. So how many ever thought about that? Amen. So some of these might be some reasons why. All in name, two of them, I just named the first one, grace and peace be multiplied through what? Knowledge. And that means, a live knowledge, a real living knowledge of God's word. The second one is humility. And there are about seven or eight factors that we have to consider when we speak about the grace of God being released into your life. I just named two of them, but Sister Hill want to talk about neighbor, so that's me. Okay, I'll let you go in a minute or two. Okay, Luke 4, we'll just read. The story of Naaman is a good story you need to read, because Naaman's story, the story of Naaman, I could get into the story of Cornelius over in Acts 10. And there are the story of Daniel in Daniel 9, 10. To get it to all of those, and by looking at all of those stories, you will see there are certain components that has to be in place before God is going to what? Release these blessings fully in your life. And we mentioned two of them, but the prayer thing is another one. Prayer. All things by prayer. And supplication, let your request be made known. And the prayer thing is just, it's just, I could, you know, we could do so much with that. Even, we could go all the way back to the old patriarchs and prophets. All of them were men of what? Prayer. Jesus' apostle, they continued in prayer, what? Daily. Everything that Jesus did, he attempted to do, he spent time in prayer before he what? He went out and, amen, and did the work of his Father. Because he didn't know, the Father had to lead him. The Father had to tell him. Most times that was revealed to him in prayer. That's the reason why we want to spend time in prayer, because you won't have a clue as to how to reach these folk today. I mean, God has to put them these things in your heart, things you can do and things that have to be in place before you are be able to what captivate the hearts of a whole lot of people that you want to get saved. All right, Luke 4. I was just thinking about all those different stories, like Cornelius, another component there, and the story of like Dorcas in the 9th chapter, I believe, of Acts. They had certain virtues that made it easy for God to release those blessings in their life that really turned their lives completely around. Okay, Luke 4, this is about Naaman. All right, and many lepers, that's a long story. How many remember the story of Naaman, the leper? Okay, we can recap that. How did Naaman know where to go to get his healing? What was it now?
It was my servant.
All right. It was a little girl that had been taken captive. That was one of his what? Wife's servants, or lived in the house. Maid. And she knew about the power of Elijah. And she said, if Naaman, my boss, could just go over where Elisha. If he could connect with Elisha, Elisha can restore him back. Although he's a leper, he can restore him back to his what? To his health. That's how the word got to the captain, Naaman. Okay, so Naaman that was communicated to him. He prepared, and they constrained him to go. And after he got to the house of the prophet and stood outside, the prophet would even see it. So he was expecting for the prophet to minister to him by what? Laying his hands on him and praying over him and giving him a whole lot of attention and speaking the word of God to him. And Elisha didn't even come out of his house to address this man's need. He told a servant that was sent, knocked on the door. He said, well, tell Naaman all he has to do is go down to a certain river and what? Dip himself 7 times. And now remember what happened? He got furious. Naaman got furious, right? I mean, he's a big captain. I mean, he's a big man. And this man wouldn't give him an audience, wouldn't take time, lay hands on him, amen, and build his faith up, pray over him, spend several hours, get him in shape to be healed. Mm-hmm. He said, I don't want to say it, just tell him to go. go down to the river, what's the name of that river? That dirty river. That was the worst one in the area. It was all, there was a lot of clean rivers around. But Elijah said, go to that dirty river and go down 7 times, and when you come up, you'll be healed. He got mad because what? His pride was standing in the way. As long as it's pride, God resists the what? Pride. But he gives what?
Grace.
Grace to the humble. Okay, now how did Naaman experience a change of mind, change of heart? Because he wasn't going to do it.
Something big or great
that
you've done that.
Huh?
Why not?
Oh. Yeah. Okay. Why not? If the prophet had told you to do something real great and big and that you could get a whole lot of what? Accolades for. But he said you would have been glad to do that. But if he told you to do, why can't you just do the simple thing that he said? So God had to what? I mean, that pride had to be what? Dealt with. Because as long as he had that type of heart, no healing. And that's true for all of us. No healing. And that takes us right back. God resists the proud, but he gives what? Grace to the humble. All right, did he get his healing? All right, so here's what it says. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elijah. No, this is not Elijah. Elijah was the one that multiplied the meal and the oil. But this is Elisha. Of course, his anointing was how many more times more powerful than Elijah's?
Double.
He had a double portion, right? Like he did twice the miracles. Okay? And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha, the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian. Okay, so we can see and understand now why he was the man chosen for God's miracle to be released into his life. Okay, why would you say the main reason why Naaman was the man? I'm pretty sure there was a whole lot of what? Lepers in Israel too. That's what it said. There were many. But none of them was healed except Naaman. Okay. Why do you believe Naaman was the one that received his healing? The main reason from this story.
His healed the rest of the population was it wasn't that the river now was make you sick. It's just that it wasn't the pristine river.
Right. So there are some waters that have healing properties though.
He said that the waters of Damascus
were
way better than that.
Well,
why did he send me over
there? Well, he found he humbled himself.
Right. He finally was and became obedient to what he told him to do.
Mm. I think it was because he was willing to go seek after the word of the Lord. And when he heard that the word of the Lord on the top of God was over here to heal, he went seeking to look for it.
But he still had to deal with that element of pride.
Yeah. So, but he still is still.
I mean,
I guess the main point is that in order for God's grace to be released into your life, you have to place yourself in a position, whatever God says. When we say in a position, that means that whatever God says you have to do to what? To receive what he's offering, that's what you got to do. If you got your own way of doing things, you might have a problem.
I think you have to be willing to put yourself in a place where you can.
Right, right. That's true. Now, the Bible says that, Scripture says that, take heed how you hear, but with measure that you hear. here, that's the measure that is going to be measured back to you again. So sometimes people do not place themselves in a position, because many times everybody that's hearing are not hearing. All right? That feels like they have what? Ears, what? That don't mean this ear here. I mean what? Spiritually. So sometimes we hear and don't hear. And sometimes it means something to place yourself in a position where you can hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Because the Spirit of the Lord is saying, give that $100 you got. How many of you think can discern that real easy? That's hard to discern. You ain't got but 100? Have the Lord asking for that 100?
If the Spirit of the Lord says, it's not hard to discern. If you know it's going
to work. Well, that's the problem.
The problem's not hard to discern. If you know it's the Lord, it's your mind.
The balance between obeying and disobeying. So, not if you know it's the Lord.
Sometimes I think the problem is that you don't talk to
them,
that you
know it's the Lord. All right, well, we better go. Everybody's looking around. Candace said sometimes we don't talk to them enough.
And sometimes we don't listen to them enough.
Yeah. Okay, but if you would go through stories like, you can write these stories down, you can get a whole lot of insight. Every virtue needed in order for God's grace to be released in your life can be revealed through the story of Daniel. If you read that, because Daniel was a man, everything he had was through prayer. He submitted to God, never projected himself as being some big, mighty prophet, man of God. And what I like about Daniel was that he worked on a secular job through six administrations, about 60-some years he worked in a political arena, and yet he got all of those revelations. They said that if we didn't have the book of Revelation, if we didn't have the prophetic teachings of Jesus, we would have adequate knowledge of end time and the sequence of how things will unfold in the end time just from Daniel's revelation. Just from Daniel's teaching and what he got from God, the visions, we would have enough information to determine exactly what would be unfolding until Jesus comes to set up the millennium reign. So that man was a man of prayer. He started out with a disciplined life, right? He didn't eat like everybody else, right? Prayed three times a day. And when the wise men of Egypt were about to be all killed and destroyed, he got with his three Hebrew friends, and they prayed until God gave them an understanding of the dream that the king had. And all through that book is based on prayer. Okay, so that would be something that we could study too, if we really wanted to understand. Now, the other one is I like this, Acts 10. All of these will be approaching those virtues in a different way. There were virtues in operation in the life of Cornelius. Why did God open the door of salvation through him? If you read Acts 10, you'll see. You'll see why. So this is something that we can take over to the new year, because I think that most of us really want to experience a greater degree of God's blessings. And I think that this is the thing that will enable us to understand the virtues that we have to be operating in for God's best to be released in our lives. So you might as well understand that by giving and tithing and things like that, that is the prima commandment that God gave us. The way you learn to fear God is learning how to obey God in the area of tithing and giving. That's the first thing that God admonishes us to do in order for us to understand and to walk in the fear of God. Trust him for what? For meeting your need, but first you what? You give to him a tenth portion of your what? All of your what? Increase. That's the first stage. If a person doesn't master that, they will be a baby believer all of their life. It's up and down, they will never be blessed, their families will never be blessed. And you will be spinning your wheels around. That's the first way God has taught us, instructed us, how to learn the fear of God. You learn the fear of God first by trusting God to what? Do what he says do about your money, because money is the most important thing to our hearts. If you never obey God in money, you will never obey him in other areas. I'm done. And I'm like, nobody's standing up cheering me tonight. All right. I hope we're going to answer some of those questions y'all been saying. What are all these blessings? All of these blessings. Where are they? Man, I'm doing this. I'm doing that. Amen. So we're going to kind of get y'all out. I started out on the right track this year. Amen. Start y'all tithing. And giving and obeying the voice of your spirit.
We want to announce Sunday service from 9 until 10:30.
Okay.
It starts at 9, and we'll be out at 10:30.
Okay.
The wedding after the dismiss.
Action. All right. All right. You heard the announcement. God bless you. All right. All stand. God bless you. May the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now and forth. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.